But really, I'm here to talk about digital disruption. This is in the third year that I've been presenting here at Power Electricity World. Those of you who have seen the previous presentations, I shared how this technology disruption has overtaken many industries. We talked about Blockbuster Video, we talked about Barnes & Noble, Kodak, etc. How the digital counterparts have come in and disrupted these additional industries. And then we looked at how these disruptors have caught up with our usually stable industry, how these changes in the way we generate electricity, energy efficiency, evolving customers, this new generation of employees, new generation of consumers, deregulation, and these innovative and pervasive technologies has forced utilities to change. And I think we covered that in John's presentation very well. Well, as Pete said in the introduction, Meralco is the largest distribution utility in the Philippines with 6.3 million customers. But now, for the first time in our 115 years of existence, we're seeing a major shift in the way power is generated and the way it's used. We're shifting and moving from the centralized one-way power system to the decentralized two-way power system. We're seeing the advent of prosumers driven by energy technology consumerization. We're seeing that evolution is really no longer an option. The traditional electricity distribution model is simply not fit for purpose anymore. This modern day utility must prepare to embrace the role of distributed system operator, facilitating these digital two-way energy flows plus this flexible, complex and dynamic market structures. We're moving from the utility controlled to the customer controlled. Electricity, and I know Pete just discussed the impact they're having in Europe in terms of energy efficiency and falling demand, but energy is still the rising force among the worldwide energy uses of energy, making up 40% of the increase in energy consumption up to 2040. That's the same share that oil took over the last 25 years. Electrification across key end users, particularly around buildings, road transport, underlies the acceleration of electricity demand relative to other fuels. And of course, we've seen that higher standards of living here in Asia and Africa results in fast rising demand for electricity-based services, and strong improvements of the economics of electric vehicles are triggering more rapid uptake for cars and electric trucks. So, where will this new power come from? Well, we all know the answer to that, mainly from renewables. 2016 was the first year in which solar and wind net additions exceeded coal and gas, and this was driven by the rapidly improving economies of renewables, which Pete just discussed. In 2020, renewables are projected to be the most economic new build option. The large shift to renewables is further catalyzed by this fast declining storage cost. And globally, more than 80% of the capacity additions will be solar, with China and India contributing more than half. In addition to this rapidly changing physical technology, we're also faced with these rapidly evolving customers. The next generation are the digital natives. Anybody who's got children, grandchildren will know exactly what I mean. They require a very different level of customer service. They're used to this convenience, this transparency, and this more tailored service. We have been forced as Meralco to adopt to these range of new digital technologies. These are classified as the third IT platform, social media, mobile, cloud, and big data. And this was the basis of my presentation just 24 months ago. These digital disruptors were the driver for our digital transformation that we started in 2016. But I've been forced, it's always good to reuse presentations, I was forced now to really update it, because these technologies are already the norm. These are no longer our disruptors. Today, there is a fresh wave of these powerful technologies that promise or threatens to disrupt us yet again. It's not over, another wave is coming. These are the new digital disruptors, which I will discuss in my presentation. Firstly, let's talk a little bit about blockchain. Any of you who invested in bitcoins big a few years ago, I guess none of you did, that's why you're still here. I didn't. But blockchain is moving from the digital currency infrastructure into this platform for digital transformation. Blockchain and other distributed ledger technologies provide this element of trust in an untrusted environment. It reduces the need for a trusted intermediary or trusted third party in the system, central authority. Blockchain could really disrupt our industry by removing the middleman. And I say that many of the utilities, we are the middlemen in many of the interactions. It will facilitate this peer-to-peer direct trading. Through this decentralized ledger can be used for smart contracts, otherwise called self-executing or digital contracts, because they can help exchange things of value, whether it's money, properties, or shares, or in our instance, power. Let me give you an example of a company in the UK called Verve, a subsidiary of Green Running. They're combining this artificial intelligence, deep artificial intelligence with blockchain to enable this peer-to-peer energy trading platform to improve accessibility to low-power, low-carbon energy. This illustration on the board here shows a simplified representation. They have an energy sensor which attaches to the electrics within your house, and it's combined with a blockchain-enabled energy trading platform. And this really could change the way that we buy and sell electricity. To avoid the cost of having a broker exchange, a local aggregator buys tokens. Those tokens give access to the platform. Through the platform, customers can then trade between themselves. Households have to ensure, of course, that they have the required funds or that they have the ability to be billed. And then they switch on the energy sensor and off they go. They start trading peer-to-peer with their neighbors. Everything else is automated. The artificial intelligence built into the energy sensor will make intelligent decisions on when to buy, when to sell, how much to offer, and how much to bid. For the utility, this could be a real game changer, disrupting the whole energy industry. If you think about it, consumers are now their own retailers and their own generators. What I just described is a mini wholesale spot market working in your subdivision, in your estate, in your building, where you are being able to participate in a local market and you're trading between your peers, your generator and your retailer. Blockchain found its way into the energy sector in April 2016, when the first energy transaction took place in Brooklyn in New York. Today, there's 112 organizations involved with blockchain technology and 40 deployed projects. Just between the second quarter of 2017 and the first quarter of 2018, over $300 million was invested in blockchain in the energy industry. Blockchain has a number of potential use cases. It could allow consumers and businesses to trade power, as I just discussed, or to switch power supplies more efficiently and quickly, or to make the existing industry processes more efficient by serving as its backbone for utilities and their smart grid management systems. Let me give you a few examples. The British startup Electron is developing a blockchain platform that could allow customers to quickly and easily switch power supplies. And the Australian startup Grid Singularity is using blockchain technology to develop this decentralized energy exchange platform that can host applications ranging from validating electricity trades to monitoring of grid equipment. Meanwhile, in Germany, the power company Innogy is running a pilot to see if blockchain technology can authenticate and manage the billing process for autonomous electric vehicle charging stations. The next technology trend I want to discuss is intelligent things, or the Internet of Things. This has really matured over the past 2 or 3 years into usable commercial grade technology. The global number of devices being managed by utility companies alone is projected to grow from 485 million in 2013 to 1.53 billion in 2020. As these IoT devices proliferate, we expect a shift from the standalone intelligent things to a swarm of collaborative intelligent devices. For example, the military is deploying swarms of drones to attack or defend military targets. And many of you would have seen this. Intel used a drone system in the US Super Bowl halftime show starring Lady Gaga, showing how drones have moved from remote control toys to intelligent devices. There wasn't 1,000 guys with beards and remote controls standing below. These drones were able to form their own patterns and interact with each other. Sorry for any drone flies. The next one I want to talk about is fog and edge computing. So fog computing is pushing the intelligence down to the local area network of the architecture, processing data in what we call a fog node or a gateway. With edge computing, it's pushing intelligence right down to the device. Fog and edge, combined with the IoT I just discussed, is all set to revolutionize data computing. These vast amounts of data, which is being produced by all these sensors, tons and tons of data, it's just impractical to send them to the cloud or send them to a decentralized engine to be processed. What we'll see is edge or fog computing will allow devices to have their own storage, to make their decisions and process that data at the edge of the network and make decisions. So you will have devices that are not receiving commands but are able to understand and make decisions themselves. And a good example of that is an autonomous vehicle. Cars do exactly the same thing. One such example to our industry is, of course, smart metering. So smart metering generates a huge amount of data, which creates a challenge for us in the IT world, moving all of that data up to the cloud or up to our on-premise systems, processing it and sending it back. If we start looking at how we can process data at the edge in the smart meter itself, maybe a much more efficient way of dealing with all the flood of sensor data. With that, only relevant data is sent up to the cloud, with a meter being able to make the decisions for itself, particularly, as I mentioned, to buy, to sell, to switch on, to switch off. Next, and perhaps the most significant, I'm sure we'll hear a lot about it today, is artificial intelligence and machine-based learning. Artificial intelligence has, of course, been around for decades, but over the past 3 to 5 years, this technology has been finding applications across a range of sectors, including energy and utility. And AI is among the fastest growing tech sector, with investments in AI startups grown to a record $5 billion. Currently, there's 3 main use cases in the utility industry. First is around renewable management. Here, use cases range from renewable forecasting, equipment maintenance, wind and solar efficiency, and analysis of storage. For example, in Germany, a machine learning program can work as an early warning system for grid operations and a system in calculating the renewable energy output over the next 48 hours. In Japan, GE is using AI to enhance wind turbine efficiency and is raising power output by around 5% and lowering maintenance costs by around 20%. The second is around demand management, with use cases covering areas such as energy trading and risk management, demand response, building energy management systems, and overall efficiencies. These algorithms, these artificial intelligence algorithms, are able to analyze massive quantities of data from satellites, weather stations, and sensors to determine patterns and forecast weather events that could impact energy generation. Because as utilities, we buy oil, gas, coal, etc., and we're at the mercy of these volatile commodity prices, AI could really help us manage our risk and do much more accurate prediction. As an example, Old Dominican Electric Cooperative attributes 4 consecutive rate decreases a year to the capabilities of advanced forecasting. And DeepMind, which is Google's AI-focused company, is in talks with the UK's National Grid to use AI to help balance energy supply in Britain. Third is around infrastructure management, so digital asset management, equipment, operation and maintenance. For example, Siemens is deploying this technology here in Asia. And after AI took over control of a gas turbine unit, nitrogen oxide levels dropped by 20%. And AI can also help improve our grid security management. So we can use AI to accelerate the detection of unusual activity, identify possible risks coming in. For example, CERN scientists are already teaching their AI system to distinguish between safe and threatening behavior on the network and take action when it's necessary. So AI really has been built into all facets of operations. One really interesting example we're looking at the moment is non-intrusive load monitoring, and it's a good example of machine-based learning. Combined with this energy hub that connects into your circuitry, it samples home energy consumption approximately 5 million times faster than a smart meter and uses these machine-based learning algorithms to identify individual appliances through the footprint that they create. This allows us to be able to tell customers exactly how their bill is broken down per appliance without having to explore smart plugs or complicated monitoring systems. The next emerging technology is conversational platforms, driven by deep domain conversational AI. This technology could drive the next big paradigm shift in how humans interact with the digital world. It's going to shift from technology literate people to people literate technology. Conversational platforms, of course, are most recognizable by these virtual private assistants, the Amazon Alexa, Siri, Google Assistant, Microsoft Cortana. Okay, in fact, the first thing I shout every single morning is Alexa, stop, as she starts playing things, switching my lights on, etc. And we're also starting to look at these chatbot frameworks as well. Gartner predicts that by 2019, it's just next year, 20% of users' interactions with smartphones will be through some type of voice technology. For utilities, this technology will not only improve the customer experience, but will also deliver the data required to increase the bottom line. One application of AI and chatbots in our industry is a company called PowerScout Messenger, which gives a Facebook Messenger that allows a chatbot to interact with customers and give them information on estimated energy savings for their home through solar, and then tell them how big of a solar panel system they might need, as well as how much they could save by switching to solar. And in Meralco as well, we're looking now in terms of conversational customer service, chatbots, and voice-enabled devices as well. While conversational platforms are changing the way that people interact with the digital world, immersive experience is changing the way which people perceive the digital world. So here we're looking at artificial intelligence, virtual reality, and mixed reality. It can be used to enhance design, training, visualization, and provides hands-free information. And use cases there are around training and around field workers using these devices to overlay information into what they see in real life, or being more efficient by allowing trainers or supervisors to give directions and send instructions to people on the field. The next emerging technology is robotic process automation, RPA, and collaborative robotics, or cobots. These help humans in practical applications like maintaining plants, keeping power lines secure, tasks that can be error-prone or dangerous. By 2020, 50% of all electricity transmission and distribution utilities will be using drones to evaluate service lines through reducing asset and inspection costs and achieving between 5 to 30% reduction. I think we'll start seeing these drones really becoming a key element. RPA bots are the most mature sector of the AI and are often being used in manufacturing and transforming the industry thereby automating these processes. An example of how they're used in our industry, a water company implemented a workflow automation system to customer service in order to improve the operation efficiency, resulting in an increase of orders from 6 to 50% of the output compared to 5 times employees. So these bots are able to automate processes that are currently performed by humans. Another one in the last 2 minutes, just an extra, is digital fabrication. So we've all seen the rise of these things like 3D printers, and these 3D printers are now starting to be used in energy industry as well. We're also looking on how energy industry can use it for printed sand molds and pellicles and more by actually designing on the computer and then the printer prints in 3D. In the solar industry, this new print medium could be a game changer, as 3D solar cells capture more sunlight than these conventional PV cells. And some people believe that 3D solar panels could be roughly 20% more efficient than flat solar panels. It could also, precision 3D printing could also drop production costs by 50%, eliminating many of the inefficiencies associated with the waste of costly materials. One example is a company called Made in Space, who looks to manufacture space objects actually in space, designed on Earth, manufactured and printed in space. The next, finally, is a digital twin. This is the digital representation of a real-world entity or system. By 2020, we'll estimate that there'll be 20 billion connected sensors and endpoints, and digital twins will potentially exist for billions of things. GE leverages approximately 500 million digital twins, which come together to represent a digital representation of the operating system. These are some of the emerging trends in our horizons. Utilities need to study, to explore, and to understand the new emerging technologies that we've discussed today and how these can provide future business advantage. These technology disruptors, along with the socioeconomic drivers, are forcing us as utilities to transform into digital enterprises, driving policymakers and utility leaders to explore new regulatory frameworks and to enable new business operations and models. Some of the technologies I've discussed here today, like digital twin, AI, and blockchain, will drive business transformation and together are going to shape the industry this year. It's clear that technologies like AI will open up many new opportunities for us. Although bots are designed to fill the traditional labor functions, it's important for utilities to develop these new sets of capabilities, to build and to manage them. The human element will always be a critical asset for utilities. the kind of skills that machines cannot acquire, those are not easy to standardize or codify into an algorithm. These characteristics are things like creativity, leadership, motivation, intuition, empathy, abstract reasoning, and lateral thinking, as well as skills with craft. So we're not all going to be replaced by robots. I'd like to hope that the artificial intelligence will help complement our own human intelligence. Our ability to keep up really is what defines us, because whether we like it or not, speed and agility will become the new norm. In a sector that's becoming increasingly digital, distributed and personalized, the door is wide open for truly innovative companies. We can only really remain relevant by being resilient and by continually adapting to technology innovation. This digital age has brought a lot of challenges, but it also brings a lot of opportunities. Those who cannot change fast enough, cannot innovate, and cannot meet the needs of ever-changing and evolving consumers will face challenges growing and may not even survive in the wake of this new digital disruption. Thank you very much indeed for your time and attention. Good morning.
It's open to questions from the audience. Yeah, Clara, question.
Gavin, as always, an excellent presentation. I think the one you gave me last year scared me. That one was terrifying. So I'm going to close my mind to the scarier bits of your presentation and come back to something very mundane and boring, which occurred to me while I was looking at your Verve slide, who was trading the blockchain on the roofs with the other roofs. I can see that growing, and I can see people with solar wanting to trade with people with non-solar. And as we all see, you know, the amount of solar is going up, but it still doesn't generate in the middle of the night, and it's still variable. We've just put solar panels on our boat, and yet we're watching as the clouds go over and the variability goes up and down. So those people who are trading, how are we going to evolve the stability of the grid and the ancillary services and the connections that are needed so that we keep the same quality of electricity while the control is being taken away from the utilities like yourselves?
I mean, that's a very good question. I think the critical to that example I gave is going to be the formation of battery technology. So even if you look at the Verve example, a lot of it relies on customers having their own in-house batteries. What I think in that example will eventually emerge is companies who operate in the estates and the subdivisions offering these services as well. So you can imagine a new plot of land being built and one area being reserved for a commercial battery storage company. And what that company will do is they will trade, they will buy and sell just like the households, and they will be competing with the households. So if the households are cheaper, you know, they won't get dispatched. The same market model, you know, the same principles that happens in our market, I think will happen in a very smaller scale. I think batteries are critical to that, in the formation of that particular model. Otherwise, yes, you would really only be trading back and forward during times. The other connectivity, the other issue I hope will always be prevalent as well, is the grid connectivity. Having possibly inside a private microgrid, a connection to the grid, but a company like Meralco will become a trading participant in the same way that the people behind the meter are trading participants as well. So if the distribution utility can't provide the power cheaper than what the neighbor can sell the solar, or what the battery company can sell the battery power, or the commercial solar can sell that, then they won't get dispatched. Of course, from an economic model on the utilities, that's where the challenge lies. The challenge lies around maintaining the infrastructure for the partial time that it's being used. And that's why, together with this, has to go major changes to our regulation, major changes in regulatory policy to reflect the changing role of utility from being 100% provider to being a provider of last resort when there's no other options available.
I have a question for David. Early in your talk you mentioned about Meralco moving away from centralized generation to distributed generation, and you repeated that at the end of your talk. How will you reconcile that? I don't want to put you on the spot. With the 10 gigawatt of coal plants in the pipeline, of which almost 50% are PSAs with Meralco, So, and this will lock you in with this base load and centralized generation for long periods of time.
I think what we'll see, well, of course, energy consumption in the country is rising at a large rate. You know, what's critical is not just to look at today, but to look at energy consumption, as you said, over the longer term. These technologies can't offer the solutions today. They probably won't be able to offer the solutions, you know, within the time period you're talking about. So it's a mixture. It's a mixture of having centralized generation, because you're still going to need to provide the volumes that you need. You need to provide for the major customers. You need to provide the large scale generation still. But it's a recognition, I think, that over time this model will change. Now the timeline for that model, I don't think was in the next, you know, 5 to 10 years. I think this is a model that will come in. But you know, we're really thinking about this, you know, quite hard. The centralized generation that's being built and that we'd like to build is entirely necessary for the energy demand that we can foresee. But I think we'll see this two-way generation coming in as well. And maybe if we're having this conversation, you know, decades down the line, then I think this the two-way generation that I've talked about will really become prevalent. But the timeline for that has to be balanced up with the immediate need for power within the country.
So thank you, Gavin. That's a very comprehensive and enlightening presentation. So the next speaker.